When balmy breezes blow, soul to soul.
Yeah.
A Friday afternoon in Kingston, Jamaica. And we are privileged because listeners and viewers, Moses Davis has brought in a sound system for us to hear and party on later on.
Yeah.
Anything could happen.
Yeah.
And it will, because this is a celebration, really, of the life of Moses Davis.
Blessing.
We decided that instead of a regular interview, it would be a great thing to ask you about the songs that shaped your life.
Yeah.
And what a life!
Seriously.
It's been amazing. I mean, 8 years of age.
Yeah.
And you're now only 28.
Yeah. I did my first song when I was like 8. Yeah? Too fancy.
How did it happen? 8 years old, how did you get into a studio? Who let you in?
It was John Jalas. Yeah, he was the one that opened the door, actually.
And that was 80?
Yeah, it was 81. Yeah, 1981.
Henry Jonjo Laws.
Yeah.
And how did he hear you?
No, I was at a competition, TST's contest, because I did it 78, and I didn't get you. It was the year of the king, Yellow Man. That was the time for him. So I came second, so I actually went back 1981 to enter and actually won that year. When I find out that I have no other talent but music, it was like age 5, you know, because I was born as a very stammer kid, so I couldn't speak.
So, you had a stammer?
Yeah, very much, like wicked stammer. Couldn't speak. So I started to sing first before I actually started to talk.
I never knew that.
All right, no, you know. So I usually sing the list to the shop, like my mom
you
used to.
You sang the list when you went to the shop for your mother?
Yeah, I need £2 of chicken, £3 of flour, see it, and big cut of butter. I used to actually sing it because it could have taken me 10 minutes to speak one word.
So,
so the music is really actually give me advice. So this is the reason why I start such an early age.
So at that age,
yeah.
What were the songs that you were hearing in the schoolyard, in your mother's house, in your dad's in your home, on the radio? What were the songs that stick with you now?
Stick with me? No, all right. Usually in my house, all right, in my house, well, I have to be honest, it's one reggae album used to in my house, and it was Peter Tosh and Bob Marley, them, the Wailers album called Babylon by Bus. Is the only reggae album you see in my house. Otherwise, it's Kenny Rogers and gospel. If you cross the bridge, there'll be no sorrow. Across the bridge, there'll be no pain. The sun will shine across the river, and you'll never be unhappy again. These are the type of song we grew up on. I'm leaving on a jet plane. I don't know when I'll be back again. Kiss me and smile for me and tell me that you wait for me and hold me like you never let me go. But what I did now, when we grew up now as a youth, and these are the type of songs that we grew up on, I turned them into music. I want new dance, Beenie Fine again, around the street and the lane and round the bend. World dance is the name and the tiger. The body dumb, the devil blind and the cripple. And I don't know why Black Wizard love it so. If you cross the bridge, your life gone in a sorrow. And if you cross the we grew up on these songs, so we take them, flip them, turn them into music. Yeah, so those are the type of music that we used to listen to as a kid inside my house. But first time here, I feel like Bamina Church, that was my song.
Peter like, Tosh. Feel like Bamina Church.
And then so I would say, preacher man, don't tell me heaven is under the earth. I know you don't know what life is really worth. You can fool some people sometime, but you can't fool all the people all the time. And now you see the light, what you gonna do? Stand up for your right. So come on and get up. I think from that day I becomes an Ethiopian Orthodox. I stopped going to church with my moms and start going to church with my father.
Really?
Yeah. Them times we have the turntable, the little red turntable with two little boxes, and you put on the record, put on the change, and it started to play. from there now, my uncle built a sound system called Master Blaster.
This is in Waterhouse?
Waterhouse, yeah. Sidney Wolf, my uncle. He used to play percussion for Jimmy Cliff. So these are the type of people that we grow amongst. Jimmy Cliff is my friend from I was like, what? Yeah, from before I know myself, Jimmy is my friend. So my uncle now built a sound system. That's where we start to learn to DJ and dubs, because tubbies usually carry the albums, the dub albums, and we used to have them and play a version and just learn to ride the rhythm.
Right there in Waterhouse, yeah, right there around the corner from Tubbies.
Yes, right down the corner from Tubbies. So my mother now used to argue every day, I cannot take the boogie agonize. You need to turn off the sound. What do I do with my picnic? Make my picnic come home and all of this. She don't know, say, I am the one that forcing the effort. You know? She think that these big man now have me over there trying to give me a job. Child labor. She said, when child you can't slave out my son.
Child labor.
But she don't know, says me, it's my idea. I need to learn to do this thing. I need to DJ right on the beat. I don't need to catch the beat from sideways. I need to catch a beat from the beat start.
So there you are. You're invited to go into a recording studio by one of the top producers on the island, Henry Junjo Laws, to make a record. What did that feel like?
Yeah, but it was a great feeling. The only problem is the record never came out on his label. It came out on Danny Dredd's label.
He was the selector for the sound system Volcano.
Yeah, yeah.
And where did you voice it?
Channel 1, Maxwell Avenue.
And was it easy to do? Was it one take? Were you nervous?
No, really, never really nervous, because I actually know the songs, you know? So you just go in the studio and put on the headphone and actually sing it one time.
Can you take us back there?
That's it. All right. So when they send me to the studio now, I'm put on the headphone and the rhythm start. Pam pa na na pa, ba na na, ba na na nam tam. Pam pa na na pa, ba na na, ba da da dam tam. Say I as a youth, not too fancy. The school where me go, it name Charlie. Me take me just lyrics.
Whoop.
Sound wicked. So I say, okay, we have one more space, because it's a disco. 45. So you have side A and side B. So I'm going to do a next one, say, over the ocean, over the sea, all of the girls and mama do over me, yeah? Over the ocean, over the sea. So I got two songs one time released. The first time now was Barry G, the disc jockey in Jamaica at the time. And Barry G played my song 2:25 on a Friday evening. I was coming from school. Friday afternoon, I was in the bus. I came off at the wrong bus stop, because as soon as him start to talk about me, we get nervous, because I don't want nobody on the bus really know what I'm me him talk about. So I press the wrong bus. Bus stop. I came off at the wrong bus stop. When him play the song, I came off like 10 blocks before my house. I walked the whole 10 blocks thinking what I'm going to do now, you know? Because my mother got hear it on the radio. My family got hear me on the radio. Now they must start to look at me different. And I don't want to be different, you know? So me actually have to leave my house, like seriously. Big man thing, me have to run away.
You did?
Yeah, me end up over Bonnie Striker Lee. That's how me get to did my first album. By leaving my house, going to Bonnie Lee. Bonnie Lee have a studio there at his house. So you have rhythms, Pantapa rhythms, and the engineer is there. So I actually voice three songs every day till I actually have an album. So at age 10, the album actually released. The Invincible Beenie Man 10-year-old DJ Wonder.
What was your mother? Your mother? She obviously found out where you were living.
Yeah. But the problem is, my mother used to work $60 a week, and I used to work $100 a week. So I give her the $60. So she realized that I am making more money than her. So, you know, yeah, she have to just leave me alone.
Big up mama.
Yes, every time, 150%.
I bet your mother's proud of you now.
Every time, trust me. You see? My mother never less than proud of me, because she knew I used to think that I was my mother's most hated kid. But I get to realize that she know that I'm a survivor and I can take care of myself. So I never need her to be there on my case at all times, because I can take care of myself. But I never realized that till I was like 15, 16. But at age 10, me need my mother to stop sing the fool music and support me. Yeah, but we get to realize that she know what she's doing. you know? Yeah, so, yeah.
So you're rolling up into your teenage years now.
Yes, good.
I mean, you've already got an album.
Yeah.
You've got a first single when you're not even, you know, you're still in short pants.
Yeah, still in short pants, yeah.
Getting scared of mommy on the bus ride home or what's going to happen to you. What did happen to you?
Well, nothing ever happened, you know, but it's the rest becomes history. I become the king of the dancehall. Nothing really happened. Because then I started DJing Lee's Unlimited Sound System with the king, Yellowman, Papa San, Daddy Life. This is when I started to know Lone Ranger. MDM Soca, Roomba, Massive Jet. Yeah, this is when I started to know all these artists. And this is before Liquor John them time.
So this is early 80s?
Yeah, early 80s. Josie Wheel them time, Charlie Chaplin time.
And the songs that, because we got to keep in mind that the songs that shaped my life.
Yeah, the songs.
And they needn't necessarily be.
These are the songs now, like me went to a dance at Clarendon. Me have a big fat girl named Pam. Same time me roll up at the dance gate. The gate man a hold on for me woman hand. One box me game nine blasted face. Money scatter out all over the place. Babylon joke me with a big 38, me a fi ball out. Let go me hand gate, Pam me come in. Let go me hand gate. Yes, these are the time where you have Michigan and Smiley now. See, no more uptown, downtown. We all come together under one ground. And we have to listen the politics struck down. These are the songs, the rich man and the poor man. Come together in a one combination. You have Charlie Chaplin. Charlie Chaplin never used to record that much. Then you have Sister Nancy, Brigadier Jerry, from Jalop Sound. Because I used to go there because my father was a 12 tribe. So we used to go to 12 tribe dance every month. 12 Tribe keep a dance every month, January, February, right through till December, then it starts over back again. But these things, as what me I tell you, say, used to happen, it's not there no more.
You're talking about Spanish Town Prison over?
Yes, there's no Ilaiwi no more, there's no Fat Jar, them gone, these people.
When dancers went till the sun rose?
Oh God, man.
Brigadier Jerry?
When dance start from 8 o'clock in the night. Dance start from 8 o'clock in the night. Everybody get ready from 6 o'clock. By 8 o'clock, dance ram. When them say alpha free, 7 o'clock. So you ever come out and come back in and pay a musical rate and dance, not done till 8 o'clock the next morning. These were the days.
And you would be there,
what?
On the mic, what? On Lee's Unlimited.
The first time I DJ on a big song was Gemini. It was Johnny Ringo on the microphone. It was Marvally. So I went to the dance and Wollamp and Ringo Pants and him checks out I was a last kid.
He thought you were a lost child.
Yeah, I was last. So this is how the beer box come in. Now. Him lift me up and put me on the tree beer box and give me the mic to tell the dance what my mother's name. So him I say, what is your mother's name? So when him give me the mic, I say, run the rhythm selector.
Because he genuinely thought you were a lost child and you must call out your mother's name looking, so she come and pick you up.
Yeah.
Lost and found.
That's that fun. So run the rhythm selector.
That's priceless.
Yeah, that the rest is history.
Where are we now? I mean, we're not even out of the 80s
yet. We're still in the 80s.
The songs that shaped the life of Moses Davis.
Still in the 80s.
You're still in the 80s, you're still in the dance hall. You've made an album.
Yeah.
And, this is a question. I was talking to Cecil, who's been driving us around Kingston over the last week.
Yeah.
And Cecil said, David, don't forget to mention to Moses Davis how important he is to the people of Jamaica. So Cecil, it is my privilege and my honor to do so. And it has to be said that you are, in many respects, very humble and reserved about the charity work that I know you have done over the years.
100%.
The money that you have raised
in
your communities.
Yes.
And that I know is important to you.
Every time.
When did it become apparent to you that you could actually do something to help?
No, well, all right. You see, as a youth, I grew up within the ghetto. You know that the only way to get out of the ghetto is actually get out, you know? But when you get out now, you have people you leave there, where you need, you know? Because Mr. Money build schools, Mr. Money, you know, supply the clinic, supply everything. So it's for you to know that you can do this because you're making this money right now, but it's not for you alone. is for you to share it with the fans, not even the fans, but the people who look at you, look forward to see you doing these things, you know?
And physically and doing physically it as well. You actually going into waterhouse and digging foundations.
Yes, God, and mix your cement and build your church and build your school and do all these type of things. You do it for the community. It's not asking for a cent or asking for help, you know? You are helping them because without them, I wouldn't be who I am today. Without the people come out and say, yes, being a man, and beat down the fence and kick in two fence and a man and say, yo, I want to hear the DJ, give the DJ the mic and these things. You wouldn't be nowhere today. So when you can, once you can do back something, do it. Don't ask for no help, just do it. You know, don't really ask for no big up or go through the newspaper and said, I do this, I do that, I do this, I do that. You're not doing it from your heart, you're doing it for bragging rights. You know, I don't do this thing for bragging rights. I do this thing because I can do it and I do it.
You've been a prolific songwriter over the years. Have you ever sat down and added up the number of songs you've written?
No. I know I get 187 number one songs, I can't tell you that.
187
number one
songs?
Yes, that I can't
tell
you.
On the Jamaican Hit Parade?
Jamaican Hit Parade, yeah.
Name three of them.
Girls Them Sugar, Rome, Sim Simmer.
The top three, probably.
Yeah.
Well, three of them.
The three of them.
Let's roll into the 90s.
Yes, good. Yes, good.
90s. I mean, we know what you're doing for a career. Your mother realizes what your career is. Yeah. You're a very successful young recording artist.
1990, I was left on the street because, you know, me get caught up in some little thing where I'm not supposed to get caught up in. And I get arrested. Yeah, I was in jail for like, what, eight months, something like that. Yeah, anyways, I came out 1991, the time when Mandela came to Jamaica and again went to the National Stadium and I got booed. Big time.
Why?
Yeah, because I think I sing the wrong song at the wrong time and I point on the wrong person. So I went on stage and said, hey, Green, I'm over there, so why you bring back the cologne where you bar? And I was pointing on the Prime Minister of Jamaica. At the time.
Didn't go down very well.
Didn't go down very well.
Not politically correct.
Not politically correct, none at all whatsoever.
In the National Stadium.
Yeah, and I got booed. The song at the time was Pinchas Bandolero.
Oh, right.
Yeah, that is the song at the time. Hey, Gringos and Pasero, I want you to make way for the Bandolero. And if you don't do that, my friend, then your number is zero. Never forget that. Then a month after that, I did a song called Spread Out, Miss Angela, Miss Awoka Monday, I will do a murder. And yeah, and then my career just start right back, right there, just start right back. Then me do, matey and a good sitting, when matey pass all the mama and miss, number one. Then 92 I did, Bad Man, Wicked Man, not Tech Man for Toy, Black in a Me and More, Kill and This, and the rest is history.
What songs were you hearing as you rolled into the 90s beyond the reggae world?
Yeah.
And which ones were important to you?
Whitney Houston, it's my singer. Yeah, chop off my neck and roll it, go down the gully. Whitney Houston was a great, 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 great singer. But it was more like, what's your name? Cyndi Lauper. Oh. Yeah, some of these people. Songs like, Mama say you can't hurry love, ooh, you just got to wait, because love ain't easy. It's a gain and give and take, and I'm the first touch, is the deepest. Those are the songs that really, you know, internationally we hear. Last night the DJ saved my life. These songs like, sometimes it make me wonder, oh, a cube is going under. Yes, and then my singers back in them time was like, Ad Stepper.
I need Kamosi.
Yeah, him never said, there's a hole in the pumpkin, and it's got to be Halloween. And if it wasn't one thing, this Jed will scream. So, yeah, these are the songs that shaped my life want to be an international superstar. Yeah, these are the songs that take me from that level to that mindset.
Stepping outside of Jamaica now, when was the first time you left the island and where did you go to?
Oh, the first time I left Jamaica, it was 1986. I went to Canada.
Yeah. To perform as an artist?
Yeah, to perform as an artist.
And where did you perform?
What do you call it? Concert hall.
And what was that like?
The murder, it was a sound system thing, where was sound name again? Upsetter. sound. Yeah, it was the sound system upset a sound. I went there with them. I was there for like what, 3-4 months.
In 1986?
Yeah, 1986. Okay. And I went back 1987. I spent like 2 years. And yeah, I went to New York then time and come back.
Okay.
And yeah, because I got DJ on Downbeat system in New York. And then DJ on upset a sound in Canada. Yeah.
Your songwriting is prolific.
Blessings.
How do you do it? How do you do it? A rhetorical question, really, because you do it. But does it come easy?
Yeah, well, it come easy to me because it's not a job. It's part of my life. It's like waking up and brushing your teeth, wash your face, well, afresh, put on your clothes. That's how it come, you know. You have to drink some tea and eat some breakfast. And once it's lunchtime, you have to eat some lunch. Dinner time, you have to eat some dinner. This is all writing is like to me. It's part
it just
of my life.
Comes.
Yeah, it's just come. Yeah.
Pen and paper or head?
Not really. Brain, yeah. Pen and paper kind of take away from it.
Really?
Because, yeah. Because by the time you think two things, you write down one. So the next one gone. So
so how do you remember it?
Yeah, well, that's, yeah. The brain is a hard drive, you know? Keep everything up there. Yes, God.
You've recorded some of your most popular songs, mm-hmm. and you've had a number, to say the least.
Trust me.
But in terms of the most successful, you've listed some of those. But what are the ones that are special to you particularly?
Oh, like Crazy Ballad, Luciana, Beenie Man, we only chase those Crazy Ballad. And I'm a sensei, me and Barrington Levy. If I'm messing up, I'm going to kill someone on a bone, make a ganja pipe. Babylon, come and tell me that, no, right? Yeah, good sense in me, enough he bone from morning till night until master God call. Yeah, these are some of my favorite songs. Murderer, me and Barrington Levy see me. How would you feel if you wake up one morning and saw a big M16 nozzle to draw? You feel like you want to disappear, but yeah, these are some of my favorite songs.
Interesting you should say that, because each song that you've chosen there is in the tradition of what you and your colleagues have done over the years.
Blessings.
Which is to answer, to enlarge upon something that was first played as a record.
Yes.
Because that's what you did in the dancehall.
Yes, God.
The vocal would play.
And then you flip it over.
Danny Dredd would flip it over, and you better have something to say.
Yes, better.
And if you didn't.
You're not there on the sound system. You just disappear. That's, I find a cloak I put over here and disappear, because it's gonna be embarrassing for you. Like, very much so.
So you take Bob Marley's Crazy Bald Head.
Yeah.
There's a Luciano interpretation.
Luciana,
your combination. You take Murderer, Barrington Levy.
Yeah. And I'm a
Sense Amelia.
Proper, proper songs. These are some favorite songs. Next song was my favorite song to me is, the Steve Biko, Do You Know? Tell me what you really know about that great man from Soweto. Do you? That's a great song for me too. When we do the Bob Marley version, Emancipate Yourself, that was Little Kirk.
Little Kirk,
yeah.
You've told the world, I remember one night you performed in Berlin and it was truly phenomenal. I mean, I'll never forget it because I saw 2 hours clock up and you were still going.
Yeah.
Another show in Hamburg, it was heading up to 3 hours.
Yeah.
The tap dancing alone.
Yeah.
Never mind, I mean, the stage show, the presence, the costume.
Yeah. You see, people come out to see you perform. Them didn't come out to see the man that fixed the mic. Them didn't come out to see the man that light the stage. They didn't come out to see the man that carry the mic and gear. Them come out to see you perform. You present a show to them. So you have to do it in your best of your ability. Now, when I come to a David Rodigan dance, I know exactly what I'm going to hear. I'm going to hear proper selection. I'm going to hear when the selection make. I'm going to hear which time the song record, so I can learn something from the music. Now, it's not like I'm going to go to hear a DJ and say, "Oh, that girl skin out your foot." I'm going to hear proper introduction and hear proper songs play. So when you come to my show, I need you to feel the same way like when I come to your show. So I am here to entertain you. I'm going to dance. Look at top dancer going unite. The girl them going to scream. We're going to wind up my body. And the girl them going to get mad and go so, whoa, you know, all of that rude boy. I'm going to fire 2 blank in the air. And all of this because this is what the people come there for. So I'm not going to make you stand up on stage and watch me like, Beenie Man is bored. No, it's not going to happen.
No, that could never happen.
It's not going to happen.
I remember a dance in New York, and it wasn't scheduled. And you came on, it was at the Q Club in Queens.
Yeah.
And I'll never forget that night. It was rammed. Yeah. And the rumor went round in the evening that you may appear.
Yeah.
And you did.
Murder.
And it, I'll never forget that. It absolutely went off in there.
Murder.
It went, do you remember that night? It was
kicking. Yeah, well, man, you don't know what it
But
I remember, man. The Q Club. Khaki suit.
Q Club in Queens. Mashed it.
It was thing that thing of birthday. What his name? Garfield, the guy that owned the club.
Yeah.
Yes. It's Garfield birthday. Yeah, I remember.
I mean, touring the world as you have.
Yeah.
Name two of the most memorable concerts you performed internationally.
Japan Splash.
Japan Splash.
Yeah.
Now put that in context because Japan Splash, that's a big thing. Right?
Yeah. Japan Splash, murder.
How many people?
Oh God, 40,000 Japanese. The last time I did Japan Splashes were like 100,000 people in the stadium. Them literally actually have to take me off the stage because the stadium was actually popping down. The world was cracking. So I have the people them, I jump for 20 minutes. I said, please come off the stage. Japan is crazy, man. Wicked.
Africa?
Up murder. Trust me. Let's see. Gambia, Nigeria. Ghana, those are West Africa. Then we go to South Africa now, we go Johannesburg, murder. East Africa, Ethiopia, Uganda, Tanzania. Wow, nice man, Africa, nice.
Being a star brings its own set of problems.
Yeah.
Jealousy, hatred,
well, bad mind.
Revenge and bad mind.
Right, true.
And we've seen this in other forms of music, not just in reggae. Problem. But of course it is a problem in reggae.
Yeah, big problem.
Why? And we don't have to be specific with individuals here because it serves no purpose. But it happens, Prince Buster and Derek Morgan, you know, right the way down the track, we've seen this rivalry and jealousy. Is it genuine or is it just to sell records? I mean, back in the day, some of it was tongue in cheek, I think. Prince Jazbo and Iroy.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, there was you and Bounty Killer, and then the union, you know, let's open the book here. How much of it was real and how much of it was hype and it generates excitement?
I feel all of it is hype. I don't think it's really genuinely real because if a man really know what Clash can do to a career, I don't think he would have it generally real because a Clash can kill your career. And a Clash can rise you to a next part in music. So I don't think a man generally want to kill your career. A man generally want to tell you something better than you. So you know the only way to prove is to sing against you.
And of course, when it comes to Clash, let's immediately home in on 1993 in one of the most famous Clashes.
Man, murder,
Sting in Jamaica. You're on stage with your Wellington boots on, your T-shirt. Yes. Yeah. I mean, how old were you then? It doesn't matter how old you were, but on comes Rodney Price, Bounty Killer, dressed as in his cowboy outfit.
World place mashup.
I mean, but you could see the fun that you two were having.
Yeah.
It was fun.
It was fun. Because you see, I cannot make it be personal. Because it when it becomes personal, that means fists are going to knock. And then in music, I don't believe that two artists should have a physical battle because we are not boxers. You understand? So I don't feel say I should show a fist on you and you should show a fist on me. I don't believe in that when it comes to artists. I feel like if a man this is personal, then if fists are going to knock, fists are going to knock. But if it's verbally, you know, him sing song, you can do that too. So I feel say, you know, in order to make it balanced, you throw a word for me throw back a word for you. See, if you fling a stone off of me, don't feel me, I stand up and fling back one. But Bunty never fling a stone, so why should I fling one? So, you know, it's just niceness. And, you know, keep you on your toes where you're supposed to be at. Yeah.
I think it's true to say that it's easier, with all due respect to singers, for them to maintain a career.
Yeah.
Because they're singers and melodies carry forth. I think it's true to say that it's harder for a DJ stroke MC stroke rapper to maintain a successful career because you can, by the very nature of the business, go in and out of fashion rather quickly.
Yeah, true.
You however.
No, me's a man in fashion, you know, all times.
Decade after decade, 80s, 90s, noughties.
Yeah, this year.
2000s and...
Yeah, because you have to adjust and adapt, Rodigan. Because remember, you know, music changed from what it was. There's no 45, which is selling no more. There's no there's no record, which is playing right now. There's no vinyl there right now. One time, you know, say, when you have a record release and you sell 7,000, 8,000 copies of number one song, now you have to go after the, what you call it now, the streaming.
Yeah.
Who is streaming? How much streaming they get? They get 6 million stream, they get 4 million stream, then you know the world are watching music. You know, the music change. So it's for us now, seeing as the original foundation artist, to take your new style and put it in our original way and keep it that way, so when the fans hear it, them know, say, okay, that's Beenie Man. But it's not for me to sit here and make you come and walk all over me and I say, him did name Beenie Man. It's not happening. Every time you see me, you're supposed to say, there goes Beenie Man.
How do you make choices? You still have to rely upon your instinct.
Mm-hmm.
If a rhythm is hot and you're not feeling it, you're not going on it? How does it work?
Yeah, well, it don't make no sense that you're not feeling the rhythm, then you go on it. You gotta actually try fit a song and something where, you know, it not really into. So if you hear the rhythm and you can, cause, all right. As an artist, it's not supposed to take you 10 minutes to find a song or a punchline or a melody for
ten
any
minutes.
Rhythm. It's not
ten
supposed
minutes.
To take you that long.
10
from,
minutes
from
to
you
get
hear
a hook.
The beat, if you're not bopping to the beat not good. Because as Shabba Rankin said best, DJ is cock up when they hear boom rhythm. So as soon as they hear the rhythm, you're supposed to think somewhere. You're supposed to rock somewhere. You're supposed to go somewhere with the music. If you're not a bop, it's not happening.
The songs that shaped the life of our very special guest, Beenie Man.
Zaga.
In his yard.
Yeah.
Thank you for the invitation. It's been a wonderful afternoon.
Blessings, man. Thank
you. We've rolled into 2017.
Mm-hmm.
And you're still on top of your game.
Yep.
You're still punching out those big hit records.
Yep.
You're still making those big videos.
Yep.
You're still getting all those hits on YouTube.
Yep.
What does the future hold?
Yeah. The future is nothing but more success, more music, you know. I think I'm going to do some movies. I really think I need to start from TV first. I need to start a series and TV series and things.
A reality show?
No reality show. Okay. TV series. Me is a reality show. My life is a full reality show itself. Every day we live it. So, yeah, I feel like I'm going to do some movie business.
So watch out, you heard the message. If you don't get a beat and a hit in 10 minutes, if you haven't worked it out, you're already in trouble.
Yeah, you're not a problem.
The songs that shaped your life in more recent years, singers and songwriters and performers, perhaps outside the world of reggae or within the world of reggae that you've really admired, because we've seen this new movement coming through.
Yeah.
The Protégé and Chronix and Kabaka Pyramid.
I like it.
How are you taking that?
I really like it. I really do like it because I like roots music. Because, you know, it's part of my foundation. Because one time, no slackness, couldn't DJ in a dance hall. As DJ take off them belt and beat you. I put soap in your mouth for wash out your mouth. Couldn't DJ no slackness. There's only two DJ in Jamaica that DJ slackness. One named General Echo, and one named Yellow Man. There's nobody else could have DJ no slackness. Man, brush your teeth for you, man. Wash out.
Carbolic soap.
Yeah, carbolic soap. Wash out your mouth. So there's no... So, you know, the music changed a lot.
Songs that resonate for you outside of the world of reggae in the last 5 years?
Alicia Keys is my singer. No One is my song. Like, seriously, it's one of the, No One and New York, Richie and Jersey, my songs. Like, seriously, I love these songs. And that's from Alicia Keys. My thing was Lauryn Hill, Trust Me. Like, seriously, Miss Education is a wicked album. I tell you that, like, every song on the album, every track on the album is my song. Even the one which she sings for her son, Zion, great, man. Now the light of my joy is in Zion. It's a murder.
Moses Davis, thank you very much. Something very special happened on Monday night. It was Bob Marley's 72nd birthday.
Yes, yes.
And there was a gathering of the clan of the Marleys, mm-hmm. and singers and performers, visitors from
and
all
Bob
over
Marley,
the world.
Long last son, when you know. Walk up on the stage, that's me.
Well, that was a moment.
Yeah.
And that's what I wanted to say. That was amazing. There was Stephen and Julian and Damien, and yeah. then
Kimani Marley.
And
Moses Marley.
Moses. Yeah.
Moses Marley. Walk out. But the problem is, all right, this is what my fans don't know, that Stephen Marley is actually my hero. He's the one that made me decide to become the star that I am today.
Stephen Marley?
Yeah.
How's that?
From Bob Marley funeral, he was playing the drum. And I said, oh, him so little bit and I play a drum. Okay? Yeah, I got to take
In
our
81?
Music serious. Yeah.
Really?
That's when I started to take music serious and started to enter contests and all about it.
Stephen Marley's responsible?
Yeah, man.
What a wonderful way to end our balmy, breezy afternoon here
yes,
in Kingston,
right,
Jamaica.
Right.
Moses Davis.
It's always a pleasure, you know, my love. Always. And it's a pleasure for having you in my house,
Thank you.
In my yard, and doing this interview with you right here.
Thank you.
Respect and manners, boss. And thank you for all your years of music.
Thank you, Moses.
Thank you. You and Barry G is the greatest thing for radio ever. Trust me. Blessings. Yeah. Beenie Man and David Rodigan, we out. Yes.
Broadcaster's voice. Rasta.